In South Florida, only the sun is hotter than Joyce Kaufman. It's the Joyce Kaufman Show on News Talk 850 WFTL. If you make sure you're connected, the writing's on the wall. But if your mind's
neglected, stumble, you might fall. Welcome back to this final hour of the Joyce Kaufman Show today. And I thought that one of the things we would want to talk about is security. I made the statement yesterday on the air that I think all churches, actually all gatherings, where particularly gatherings where the public is all facing in one direction, need to start thinking about securing themselves. That by the time law enforcement is able to get to the scene of an active shooting, it is way too late. And as we saw yesterday, even a citizen who was properly armed may not be able to get there within the first few minutes. So having people on the premises, to me, seems like a great, great idea. But I found the name through a friend of mine of a recognized professional in the fields of security and preparedness. He's the founder of Technon LLC, and his name is Joe Gehr. How are you, sir?
Hello? Joe, glad to be on your show.
Oh, well, I'm glad to have you on my show, particularly once I found out that the reason you're probably as good at this as you are is because you were an officer with the IDF. And if ever there was a country that had to learn how to deal with terrorism on a daily basis, it's Israel.
Absolutely. That is a fact that we're not very thankful for, but it's just the reality of this history of our country, right? We've been dealing with violence and terrorism for over 60 years. And I like to say we have very special doctrines that have been written with a very special ink called blood, right? Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of experience and adapting to things that may harm you.
Yeah. There was an article today in the American Thinker by a Shula Romano Horing, who's an attorney there in Israel, about why Israelis are so successful. And I think the lesson for Americans is because they do not depend entirely on law enforcement or the military, but citizens in Israel look out for one another. Do you find that to be true?
Absolutely. And Joyce, with your permission, I'd just like to give a statement here. I think one of the frustrations that a lot of the security professionals have had in the last years is that, you know, this whole issue of gun violence, so-called gun violence, and all these incidents always, you know, spur the discourse on gun disarming and a lot of politics, a lot of emotions. But here's a sad truth. The sad truth is these things will keep on happening, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if it's a terrorist attack by jihadis or a terrorism from extremists on the left side or on the right side, right?
Right.
Or a mental illness person, or it doesn't matter if it's a legal firearm or an illegal firearm or a rented truck, right? The reality is unfortunately, the world we live in today is a world where we need security. Anytime we have a group, we have a venue with a public access to a venue that has a group in it, today, in today's day and age, we need security, period.
Yeah.
And then the question of what is security is also debatable, right? And unfortunately, I feel like some other colleagues of mine that the focus on security here in this country has been too much on theft protection and you know, preventing people from misbehaving, etc., and has not really been the focus on preventing attacks like these.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
it's something that can be done, but it requires a shift of paradigm. It requires a different mindset on various sides.
Yeah.
On the one hand, in terms of education, look, we have a formula in Israel for the successful security. We call it the 20-20-60 formula, which means 20% physical security, 20% technology, 60% human factor, i.e. training, protocols. That's something that we need to adapt here. And, you know, unfortunately, we've been spending billions of dollars in technology, I can tell you, I can talk about a lot about the airport security, for example. Billions and billions of dollars in technology that can detect yesterday's bomb when the terrorists will use tomorrow's bomb, right?
Nice.
So they're always one step ahead. And it really boils down to the human factor, in my opinion. That's one thing that we should change over here. And again, the thing here is it doesn't matter what the motive is, right? The what we call the modus operandi is pretty much the same. It's either going to be a shooting attack or a ramming attack, or there's so many items on the menu that these attackers have. And yet the way to prepare for them is it's pretty much the same.
Right.
We actually put together right after the Vegas attack, we actually blended two courses that we're now offering for the staff of hotels and shopping centers.
Mm-hmm.
And it's basically, in a nutshell, what it is we think that it's critical today also to educate the not only the law enforcement personnel, but also the staff, the regular staff, for example, of a hotel, right?
Nice.
The bellboy, the front desk guy, the housekeeping personnel, if they're all trained in detecting suspicious behavior, for example, right?
Right.
Now we just earned, hundreds, not thousands of additional eyes that can spot anything suspicious and can report it. And that's where all the prevention activities start, right?
Correct.
That on the one hand, and then on the other hand, they are also the staff. They are also the staff of the place or the members of the church in this regard. They are also the real first responders.
Right.
Remember that in these incidents, seconds equal lives. And the fact is that even the best police departments in the country will be there. Will be there only after a few, 2, 4, 5, 6, 10 minutes, which is obviously too much.
Right.
Right.
Now, I happened to, after this incident took place, I talked about how when I was sitting in my house of worship on Sunday, I happened to know that there is someone who is seated up on the bima behind the pastor who is armed and watching that back door. There are two people posted in the church at various locations who are also there to be aware of who comes in and what is transpiring. And then people like me, there are a number of parishioners or congregants who are licensed to carry weapons and do, no matter where we go, who are extra eyes, as you point out. And I believe that every church is going to have to put a plan in place, every synagogue, every mosque, where an active shooting situation can be at least, maybe delayed or ended by the people inside the building at the time.
Right. And again, Joyce, here the keyword here is prevention. And having the right mindset, having the right education, you can actually prevent a lot of these things from happening. We actually put together a course. You can look it up online, preventingthenextattack.com. And what you'll see there is, again, it's very much based on training people, right? And having the right people trained and then having the right methodology. We talk about something we call the comprehensive and proactive security strategy, right? And so once you have a group of people that are trained, for example, in a place like a church or a synagogue or any other venue like that, something that is critical is obviously having good access control. And for that, you can do a combination of technology and human factor, et cetera. But once you have that access control, then we like to talk about something we call the tiers of security approach, which basically is, think of it as layers of security. So I'll give you in a nutshell what it is. The first layer is way outside of the perimeter, right? It can be across the street or either further away, depending on the situation, where the bottom line is we want the first layer's goal is to create deterrence.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? A lot of these attacks don't happen out of the blue. The attackers come, they do what we call hostile reconnaissance or surveillance, and at the end of the day, they want to pick a target that is easy to attack, a soft target, what it's called.
Right.
So they're going to be successful. So by putting strategies in place, you can actually deter them, right? You can make the attackers understand that it's not a good, it's not a good target for them to attack, and they'll just go and look for a different one. That's
right.
The first layer. And you can do that today using deception with a lot of different elements that are not actually that expensive.
Right.
The second layer then becomes detection, right? Once you have this secure perimeter, you need to know when somebody crosses that line. And again, you can do that through technology, or you can do that through human eyes, or you can do it through a combination of things. The third layer we then call delay. You have to have some type of delay mechanism once you detect, right? You have to have this delay mechanism so that the fourth layer, which is the response, right, can organize the effort and go and respond. And then we usually, when we talk about a response, we talk about response in two directions. One response element is going to go and basically look for the threat, right? Rush towards the threat and try to neutralize it as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. And then the other effort of the response takes care of evacuating or locking up and then basically protecting the people, right?
Right.
So this is something we've done for churches, for synagogues, for the past 10 years maybe. And by the way, it's a combination of various security efforts, including law enforcement, canines for doing the sweeping, private security guards, trained volunteers, right? Again, the key word here is training. Mm-hmm. And then even regular members of the community who can help with various roles. This includes doctors, paramedics, and then just even people that know the congregation, right? Having someone maybe even, 70, 80 years old, and he's been there for a long time and he knows everyone, that's a real important asset to have in one of your access control points so that he can identify who belongs, who doesn't belong. He can save you a lot of questions, right, when trying to see who's coming into that community.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, this is something that can be done.
Right.
But then, again, the frustrations, I'll tell you what I think needs to change in the mentality, the collective mentality here is twofold. On the one hand, the security companies providing the guards are really providing guards that are really not trained for this.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason they're doing that is because their clients are not willing to pay a little more for trained security guards.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's kind of like the chicken and the egg.
Right.
And I don't know where we're going to break that, that cycle, but it's going to have to change somewhere. And that's basically, and then the other thing is really getting organizations and groups of people. And again, this can be, you can talk about concerts, any shopping centers, hotels, private events, right?
Mm-hmm.
People have to understand that, unfortunately, and I don't care what your politics, if you're a Democrat or Republican, it really doesn't matter. These attackers don't really care who they kill, right?
Yeah.
But we all want to preserve our lives. So we just have to understand that in today's day and age, we have to spend a little more and allocate that to protecting our lives. I think that's the most basic thing that we should need to understand, but we don't. And then every time we have one of these unfortunate incidents, unfortunate attacks with, that are really heartbreaking, again, we start politicizing and looking at numbers where the reality is, if you want to be really, protect your fellow Americans, it's just as simple as going to the CDC website and looking for the leading causes of death, right?
Right.
You're not going to find gun deaths anywhere near the top of that list.
That's
what
correct.
Do we have there? Mm-hmm. Heart disease, right?
Yeah.
600,000 a year. Smoking, right?
Right.
Can we prevent that?
Obesity,
Even secondhand smoking, Joyce, has more deaths per year than gun violence.
Oh, I know.
And then you have, you can talk about the pharmaceutical industry and the amount of deaths that have come because of various things there, I don't even want to get into that.
No, but you're
even
right.
Things like traffic accidents. So look, if it's about saving our people, let's focus on the things that matter. The problem is that, of course, gun violence and these attacks they create a lot of news stories, right? It's
right.
Like a good,
they're very
the attention.
That's right.
And then, unfortunately, by replaying these images over and over and over again of these attacks, what we are doing is we're actually helping the terrorists, when it's a terrorist attack, to fulfill their goals. The
Absolutely.
Media then becomes their force multipliers, and then they bring that attack. For example, in Israel, we've had many, right? So I can tell you one famous one. In a pizza place in Jerusalem, Sparrow, where unfortunately, and there was a terrible attack, there was a suicide bomber attack. We had, I think, over 10 people died there, or maybe 20, I don't remember. But it took the media, by replaying those scenes over and over again, took the terror of that moment into everybody's living room, right? Watching
Absolutely.
The TV.
Absolutely, yeah.
So then these are the questions we must ask ourselves.
Yeah,
so.
I agree. Hey, I really appreciate your time, Joe. I hope I can tap into your expertise again. I don't think this subject is going away.
Unfortunately, and always welcome.
All right. Thank you so much.
Me.
Yes. Founder of Technon LLC, Joe Gehr, will You know, listen, that's the kind of advice that I'm looking for. How do we circumvent the bad guys?
Want exclusive content you don't get on air? Stay connected on our website at 850WFTL.com.